Hello everyone, and welcome to CAMSA Connect and our special Good Friday service.
Easter in Cambridge is something many people around the world will have shared in through the annual Easter from Kings service, which is televised internationally and features a selection of music and gospel readings each year. It takes place just behind us in the chapel of King's College in Cambridge, and you'll be able to catch the service tomorrow evening on BBC Two.
For our CAMSA Connect Good Friday service, we're not in King's College Chapel, but we have come into Cambridge. A few months back, we had the idea that we would try and hold our Easter services outside in the streets. But the restrictions in place because of coronavirus means that we can't gather in the streets exactly as we would have liked. However, we can bring you this online service.
That's right. Once again, we're keeping within the current rules and coming to a public space. This Holy Week, we're imagining what it would look like if the Easter story took place in Cambridge. And we invite you to do the same. What would the Easter story look like if it took place in your village, town, or city?
On Palm Sunday, we imagined what it would be like if Jesus rode into Cambridge on a donkey. And today, on Good Friday, we imagine what it would be like if Jesus was crucified, died, and buried here. With the help of the wonderful Cambridge Citadel family, we bring you a Cambridge Passion.
So let's begin our worship with a wonderful song from Good Friday that speaks about God pouring out his love in Jesus on the cross. Here is love, vast as the ocean.
Here is love, vast as the ocean, loving kindness as the flood. When the Prince of life, our ransom, shed for us his precious blood.
Well, we've just been singing about the shedding of Jesus' blood on that first Good Friday. Jesus Christ was crucified on a cross located on a hill. So we've come to a hill, south of Cambridgeshire, to the Gog Magog Hills, where you get a wonderful view of Cambridge. If Good Friday were to happen here in our city, this could well be the place where the crosses would be placed, a hill just outside the city.
In the Gospels, we read that Jesus was crucified on a hill called Golgotha, which means the place of the skull. There he was put to death as a sacrifice for our sins. But why a sacrifice? Well, in Old Testament times, a sacrifice was the way God required his people, the people of Israel, to atone for their sins.
They were required to make an animal sacrifice, and though the practice may seem odd to us living centuries later, in those ancient times in the near Middle East, it was what God required of his people in that culture. Let's not forget that there was something bigger happening. God was making the Israelites into a promised people to live in a promised land and ultimately to deliver the promised Messiah.
And this Messiah, Jesus, would one day become the ultimate sacrifice. No more would people need to sacrifice an animal. In the words of John the Baptist, Jesus would become the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world.
And that's what happened on Good Friday. Jesus' death was the sacrifice that needed to be made so that every person who has ever lived and ever will live can have their sins, their own selfish thoughts and actions forgiven. So as the New Testament tells us, sacrifice for sin is no longer necessary.
Well, in a few moments, we're going to listen to some musical reflections as one of our musicians, Mary, plays the piano for us. First, though, with the help of the Cambridge Citadel family, let's come before God in prayer and thank him for the gift of his son, Jesus.
Dear God, we remember today the pain and suffering of the cross and all that Jesus was willing to endure so we could be set free. He paid the price, such a great sacrifice, to offer us the gift of eternal life.
Help us never to take for granted this huge gift of love on our behalf. Help us to be reminded of the cost of it all. Forgive us for being too busy or distracted by other things, for not fully recognizing what you have freely given, what you have done for us.
Thank you, Lord, that by your wounds we are healed. Thank you that because of your huge sacrifice we can live free. Thank you that sin and death have been conquered and that your power is everlasting.
Thank you that we can say with great hope, it is finished. For we know what's still to come, and that death has lost its sting. We praise you, for you are making all things new. In Jesus' name, Amen.
Thank you. The Bible reading is taken from Matthew chapter 27, verses 45 to 54. From noon until 3 p.m, darkness came over all the land. About 3 p.m, Jesus cried out in a loud voice, "Eli, Eli, lema sabachthani," which means, my God, why have you forsaken me?" When some of those standing there heard this, they said, "He is calling Elijah." Immediately, one of them ran and got a sponge. He filled it with wine vinegar, put it on a staff, and offered it to Jesus to drink. The rest said, "Now leave him alone. Let's see if Elijah comes to save him." And when Jesus had cried out again in a loud voice, he gave up his spirit. At that moment, the curtain of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom. The earth shook, the rocks split, and the tombs broke open. The bodies of many holy people who had died were raised to life. They came out of tombs after Jesus' resurrection and went into the holy city and appeared to many people. When the centurion and those with him who were guarding Jesus saw the earthquake and all that had happened, they were terrified and exclaimed, "Surely he was the Son of God." Amen.
By the end of Good Friday, Jesus is dead and buried. He suffered and died not because of what he had done wrong, but for all the sins of the world. There is no one in the world who has never done anything wrong, and so Jesus gave his life as a gift for us so that God will forgive our sins and welcome us to eternal life.
Yeah, and Good Friday is good because it's when Jesus went into the darkest place of all so that we need never be afraid. Whatever we've done wrong, Jesus gives us a chance to get right with God. And whatever we suffer, Jesus shares our pain. And when we die, we don't need to be frightened because Jesus has been there before us. And because of him, death is not the end.
Well, shortly we'll be heading out of history and into the present day as we take you to Tenison Road in Cambridge and our Salvation Army Hall. As we make our way there, we invite you to listen again to some music, this time from some members of our band who are going to bring to us a piece of music entitled Rivers of Mercy.
This is a lovely piece built on Sidney Cox's song Out from His Wounded Side. As you listen, perhaps you want to thank God that because of Good Friday, His mercy and his grace is freely available to you and me and to all people everywhere.
So here we are then outside our buildings in Tenison Road, back into the 21st century. We read the following words in scripture: hard pressed, perplexed, persecuted, struck down. And as I read those words, I thought to myself, I imagine that there are hundreds, if not thousands, of people around this country, even around the world, who could take one of those words and say, yes, absolutely. I have felt like that over this last year. We might feel like that for various reasons, nothing even to do with the pandemic, just because there are other things going on in our lives that have made life slightly difficult. So I think it's really important on this Good Friday, this good day, that we tell you that God loves you. And he showed his love by sending Jesus to die on the cross for us. But you know, those words that I read earlier in that scripture are not the whole scripture. If we read them in context, we see that actually it's not negative at all. It's hopeful. And it's from 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verses 7 to 10. Let me read it to you. But we have this treasure in jars of clay to show that this all-surpassing power is from God and not from us. We are hard-pressed on every side, but not crushed. We are perplexed, but not in despair. Persecuted, but not abandoned. Struck down, but not destroyed. We always carry around in our body the death of Jesus so that the life of Jesus may also be revealed in our body. Now, the jars of clay that are being spoken about here are ordinary, nothing special jars of clay, a bit like this one here. It's actually from the Holy Land, and so it's something that would have been used. The interesting thing about these jars of clay is that, yes, they might have looked ordinary and would have been used for ordinary things, but they were also used to store great treasure. Treasure like coins that needed to be transported from one place to another. It could also hold jewels that needed to be hidden in a home. And even manuscripts were stored in jars of clay, for instance, the Dead Sea Scrolls. So when Paul talks about the jars of clay, he's not talking about an actual physical jar of clay. Instead, he's talking about, well, you and me. We are the jars of clay, ordinary people. And what Paul is saying is that we don't have to be ordinary. Instead, we can have treasure inside of us. And that treasure is to have Jesus. When Jesus willingly turned his face towards Jerusalem, he did so knowing what would happen. He knew that he would be tried and convicted, though innocent of any crime. He knew that he would be battered and bruised, knew that crucifixion was where he would end up. And even though it was the most horrific form of torture and death, still, he allowed himself to be whipped, mocked, spat at. He endured a phony trial. He had nails hammered into his hands and a crown of thorns pressed none too easily onto his brow. And he allowed it because he wanted to show the world, that's you and me, even all these years later, how much he values us and how much he loves us. Scripture actually tells us that this is how God showed his love to us, in that he sent his one and only Son into the world that we might live through him. This is love, not that we loved God. And I think that's such an important phrase, that he loved us first and sent his Son as an atoning sacrifice for our sins. He loved us even before we knew him. And even if we never say that we love him, he loves us. He willingly sacrificed his body and shed his blood to buy us our pardon. And if we are willing to accept that sacrifice, to believe in him, then we are freed from condemnation. The prison that we might feel that we are living in, well, we can be released from that. The sin that so easily ensnares us, he can untangle us from it. If we are feeling broken and bruised and uncertain and worried and anxious, then Jesus says, my love for you will fill you up. It will bring you peace. It will restore you. It will make you whole. If anyone is in Christ, believes in him, trusts in him, accept the sacrifice of his blood for them, if they are joined to him by faith as their saviour, then you are a new creation. The old has gone and the new has come. Oh, the jar of clay may look exactly the same. It will age and get old, but inside we will be changed, made new, whole again. We will know our worth and our value. And we will be able to say confidently that yes, we are hard pressed on every side, but we aren't crushed. We are perplexed, but not in despair. Yes, persecuted, but not abandoned. Struck down, maybe, but never destroyed. And at the end of that passage of scripture, we read these words. Therefore, we do not lose heart. Though outwardly we are wasting away, yet inwardly we are being renewed day by day. Jesus died for you because he loves. I'm stood outside our building, which although you probably can't see, but actually might be able to hear, there's work going on as it's being refurbished. So there's rubble and dirt, there's broken bits of walls, there's timber lying all around. And in order for it to be beautiful, the Salvation Army at Cambridge need builders, architects, project managers to put together everything that we believe it can be. But when you come to faith in Jesus, you don't need anybody else to do anything for you. You don't even need to do anything. Jesus has done it for us. He paid the price to free us. He loves us. Now, you're going to hear some words from a very beautiful song. You are my strength when I am weak. You are the treasure that I seek. You are my all in all. Maybe you need to make those words your prayer. And may you, this Good Friday, know the treasure, this treasure, Jesus, in your own jar of clay.
You are my strength when I am weak. You are the treasure that I seek. You are my all in all. Seeking you as a precious jewel, Lord, to give up, I'd be a fool. You are my all in all. Jesus, Lamb of God, worthy is your name. Jesus, Lamb of God, worthy is your name. Taking my sin, my cross, my shame, rising again, I bless your name. You are my all in all. When I fall down, you pick me up. When I am dry, you fill my cup. You are my all in all. Jesus, Lamb of God, worthy is your name. Jesus, Lamb of God, worthy.
Lord Jesus, we thank you for your sacrifice on the cross. Thank you that you became the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. Thank you that you paid the price for our sins and that you help us each and every day. We praise you that when we fall down, you pick us up.
Jesus, we are truly thankful for the extent of your love stretched out on a cruel wooden cross. We have dwelt on the pain you bore for us and are truly grateful for the forgiveness that you offer. As we go out into the world, help us to live in the wonder of this goodness and marvel at your endless grace. In your name we ask it. Amen.
Well, this is not the end of the Easter story. On Easter Day, we will hear what happened in the garden where Jesus was buried. It's the world's happiest ending, so please join us for our Easter Day service.
Of our final song, the great hymn writer Charles Wesley is reported to have said that he would give up all of his own hymns to have written this one. This beautiful song expresses a deeply personal and experiential response to the sight of the crucified Christ. So be blessed as we sing When I Survey the Wondrous Cross.
Thank you.